Forget everything that you think you know about comics. Some say that there are two types of people in this world, those who drink beer and those who enjoy a good comic. But damn it, we are the bridge. And to that we say, cheers. We are your guardians, your watchful protectors from everything mundane. Because in the real world, you either die a hero, or you drink long enough to see yourself become the villain. The ageless debate of what's right and wrong brought to your headphones with the simplest of solutions. With great beer comes great responsibility. And we accept that responsibility. For in brightest day, in blackest night, no evil shall escape our sight. We are Hop Heroes, bringing the relevance of great beer and comic book stories to light.
Hello and welcome to another edition of Hop Heroes, the show where we talk about our favorite drinks and our favorite heroes.
Hey Jordan, how's it going?
Yay, yay. Big announcement. Big announcement.
It is a big announcement.
It's a Christmas
miracle.
My family
doesn't even know. I'm recording this. Zach and JR, you know, because I love you more than my parents. And that's pretty much where we're at.
I've always kind of known that.
I know. I'm surprising them on Christmas Eve that I'm moving back to Washington, me and Sammy both. So right now I'm sitting in my empty apartment with boxes everywhere because the moving company is doing a two-day expedition. They knocked out today and they got tomorrow, and then everything's gonna be gone, and I'll be coming back on Thursday. So my computer's not here, my microphone's not here, and I am talking into my phone. So if the audio is shitty, I apologize. I know this is the conclusion of our Mandalorian saga, so it breaks my heart, but there has been a lot going on the past 2 weeks. I did find an apartment last week in Seattle, actually. I flew down for a quick trip.
I disapprove, by the way, but I know that doesn't matter.
Zach sent me probably 30 listings in Maple Valley by his house, but they just didn't fit my aesthetic requirements. So I went through each
one. What are your aesthetic requirements? Let's talk about this, though, because you're working in Bellevue. So why? How did we land in Seattle to live?
If there is more than 1,000 square feet, I get anxious. So I want a box, dude. I want to be in... I want my couch and my bed, and then, like, the floor is lava. I have to crawl.
You get anxious?
Like, that's what I'm looking for. No. I just didn't want to, honestly, I didn't want to go north, because 405, fuck 405. I know it's COVID right now, but who knows when that shit comes
back. Yeah, but you're going to have to take that bridge now every day.
I know. Shit. But it's not the same. From what I've been told. But also, we are going to be moving around a lot. You know, we moved to Anchorage, moving back to Seattle, probably moving out of state after that. And we just we want to take advantage of living in Seattle while we can, because who knows where we go next. And if I go to fucking Ohio or fucking, like, Arkansas next, I will never be able to experience living downtown in a metropolitan city.
I feel that.
So, Cleveland?
That makes that.
We want to take advantage of the situation.
I feel you on that one. I hear Seattle is a beautiful place to be in the middle of in the quarantine. It's real.
So it's actually the best time to move to Seattle. Worst time to live in Seattle, absolutely. everybody's moving out of Seattle, so we're getting great deals. They're, like, giving us free months of rent, discounting our parking. Like, it's actually going to be cheaper to live there than it is currently where we're living.
Wow. So what?
It's the time. Whoa. It's the time of the fucking... Yeah. Of our life.
There's, like, nobody there either.
That's nuts.
There's nobody downtown.
No. We even checked out Renton and shit, and this
desolate.
Is cheaper than Renton. This is, like, it's nuts.
Everywhere else is expensive. Isn't that funny? Seattle raised the rates because of how big Amazon made it, and now, like, it's empty. Everybody still has the same rates outside of, except for Seattle is desolate. Yeah. And so
everywhere around
prices.
Seattle went up because of this shit. Because
they're going to hike those rates up, though, in, like, a year.
Yeah, they will.
Oh, yeah, no way. For sure. I signed a 16-month lease, so as long as it happens after that, I'm good. Fuck.
Yeah.
But yeah, that's the audio, but that's not what we're here for. We're here to talk about Mandalorian, but before we go there, Our third host, published author and future banana hammock model, Zach Barlow. What? How you living, kid?
Pretty good. I'm not a future banana hammock model.
Leopard
that
print.
Was a weird.
Don't limit yourself. What are you talking about? You can
weird,
do it.
Misstep there, but I'm doing good, man. I'm getting ready for Christmas. I'm excited. Tis the season.
Tis the season.
The Mandalorian season finale. I feel like we've been building towards this for a couple months now, so it's
as
big.
We go
this is big.
On,
yeah. It's end of an era, really, until the next season comes out. But
the times we.
You know, I'd like to thank John Favreau.
Johnny Fab.
My mom for taking me to the premiere of Star Wars Episode 1 by myself and for getting me there. Because I think that really made me a lifelong Star Wars fan. Yeah, anyway, I'm good.
There you go.
Good to see you, bro. Good to see you. Yeah. We are concluding the saga and we have a two-parter coming to you. We have, well, not two-part episode, but a two-episode reflection. We have Chapter 15, The Believer, and Chapter 16, The Rescue. Coming your way. But before we go into The Mandalorian, we got to talk about them drinks. So we have Zach doing the beverage breakdown this week, which I am giddy for. So without further ado, let's go into that breakdown.
Break it down again. All right. I'm pretty excited about this. This is a brewery that I've known about for almost a year, but I've never actually had their beer before. They're called Metier Brewery. They're in Woodinville, Washington, and they are the one and only black-owned brewery in the state of Washington. The only one.
Really?
And
wow.
It's just really dope to be up there. So the other day, we just drove out there. We said, fuck it, let's just go. And you know, we asked if they do beers to go. They do. So they give you these cans, but really this is just from the tap. And they what they do is they pour it into this can, and then they have a canning machine right next to their tap. So they just throw it in the canning machine and can it up for you, and then you know, send you on your way. So I thought that was pretty cool. I've never seen a canning machine. Yeah, so Metier is the brewery. I am drinking Horizon IPA, which is their award-winning flagship beer, and it is described as deliciously citrus IPA brewed with sweet orange peels. This brew has a balanced bitterness and is way too easy to gulp down. Magnum, Amarillo, Azaka, and Idaho 7 hops. It's a 7.5 ABV. And so pretty hefty, and we'll give a review here.
In your frosted glass, which I know I'm required to mention.
Yeah, you gotta understand that the glass means everything. The gel is frozen within the glass. So the color is pretty golden. It's actually a little bit lighter than I would expect, especially for like a citrus IPA. I think that normally when you think about citrus IPAs, you think about hazy IPAs. This IPA is not hazy at all. There's no like cloudiness to it. It's actually quite crisp. You can see through it. It almost could be mistaken, I think, as like a lager, a blonde. But once you kind of get a taste of it.
So good.
What's that's not a lager or a blonde. You know that for a fact. It has a decent bite. You do taste that orange flavor. It doesn't shy away from the bitterness. I think that some IPAs kind of try to like mask its bitterness with like a sweet palate. This one is not doing that. It's kind of just saying, yeah, we're here. This is a 7.5. There's going to be a kick, which I respect. I like it. I definitely can taste that citrus. It's a bit bitter, crisp, and it kind of does the job for me. When I drink a cold IPA, it's weird, but like, have you ever drinking really fucking cold water and you drink so much of it that like the back of your throat kind of hurts a little bit? Like it's, and then you get this.
It hurts so good.
It's like,
though.
Yeah. It's. I've always thought that IPA's like kick was a similar kind of experience for me, where it's kind of like the back of your throat. It's kind of like it's like a not great, but like it's a refreshment. It's like telling you that you're. It's a refreshing type of experience, and
it
I think
barks.
This IPA
barks
has that.
Bite.
has that bitterness and that kick to it that I really look for in IPA. So I highly recommend. I have a lot more of these beers that I'm going to be trying over the holidays, which I'm really looking forward to. Horizon is their flagship. It's kind of their bread and butter. So this is what they built their franchise off of. So it's cool to start with this one. But solid IPA, and shout out to Metier for having us. And you done good.
How do you spell Metier? How do you spell Metier, see?
M-E-T-I-E-R.
Metier. Okay.
Metier Brewery in Woodinville, Washington. M-E-T-I-E-R.
Yeah, we're always talking about supporting local businesses, but it's never been a more important time to support local black-owned businesses, so that's fucking awesome.
Yeah.
Check out Metier. I am not going to go too deep into my beverage breakdown because I'm just drinking Elysian, but it's their Bifrost Winter Ale, and long story short, it doesn't taste like a winter beer, which I was at first like disappointed with because like I'm in the winter season. I want that heavier beer. This one is 8.3%, and it tastes like a hazy IPA. So there's a lot of citrus and very little like spice or sweet or cinnamon or whatever they're going for with the usual winter beers. The maltiness is gone. It just tastes like a pale ale, and it's super, super refreshing. And it has 8.3. So at first I was disappointed because it's not a winter beer, but I realized that this will get the job done and you won't even know it's happening. So it's kind of impressive. So that's my thought on Elysian's Bifrost. It's going to be good. You're going to drink around the fire. You're going to have two or three, and then you're going to be sitting on Santa's lap and you won't even own it.
See, those are my schemes, and these are my plans. Hot tips for the boys. Fresh news from the bars. When it's all mixed up, better break it down.
All right, so this follows the last two episodes, is chapter 15 and 16. So chapter 15 is The Believer. Dune uses her new credentials as a marshal of the New Republic to transfer Mayfield, and Mayfield is Bill Burr. They have a plan to get follow Moff Gideon's cruiser because he has little baby Grogu. If I said that right,
you
this
killed
time.
It, dude.
And
you're
doing great, dude. You crushed that.
I'm
so proud of you.
And so they need Mayfield, because he has credentials from his past life, and he needs to get to a kind of like a special base off of, you know, like a, I guess you would call it like a fort kind of area, and he needs to go put the credentials in it to track. Yeah. And so this is kind of a bigger episode, because this is one where Mando was forced to remove his helmet. You know, it is a transfer, kind of what we call like an in-between episode, but the big part is you get to see Pedro Pascal's face for the first time.
We talked about this too earlier in the season, like the significance of like different Mandalorians' ideologies, and how like not every Mandalorian is built the same, and a lot of that is showcased through their use of armor and like who shows their face and who doesn't. And so this push for Mando or Din Djarin to like start to be forced to remove his helmet, I think is significant in a lot of different ways, but we can get to that later.
Yeah, because Bo-Katan didn't give a fuck. She took her helmet off right away.
Yeah, and that was a beef that they had in the very beginning when they met. If you don't remember, when they first met, he saw that Bo-Katan had her helmet off, and his first comment to her was like, "Give me your armor. You're not a Mandalorian." Because his belief is like, if you don't believe what I believe, like if you're not the type of Mandalorian I am, which is from Death Watch, which is like actually more of a like extremist sect of Mandalorian, then you're not Mandalorian at all. And Bo-Katan is literally like the princess of, she's like the leader of Mandalorians, who is a bit more relaxed on those rules. So
to be fair, I think
that's a big kind of plot point in this story.
That's like the second line of dialogue in Mando's like mental capacity is like, hey, what's your name? Give me your armor. You're not a Mandalorian. Like, that's the second thing he says when he meets people.
Yeah, because I think he's a zealot, dude. Like, I think he's an extremist. Like, for real. Oh, yeah. And I think that when he sees people in armor, the first thing he does is essentially check their gangster. And, like, if they don't measure up to, like, his fucking standard of Mandalorian, then he's like, give me your shoes. Like that's, like, the type of Mando he is.
Before this episode, before we started recording, we're like, all right, we're going to let Jared get through the whole story of chapter 15 and the whole story of chapter 16.
Never happens.
And then
it never happens.
It will never happen, ever.
All right, but I'm done. No, I'm going to fade out. Go ahead.
No. I love it. Bring it back,
it's
dude.
Fine. It's fine. It's great. So there's a lot that goes on. Obviously, there's like the great thing about Mandalorian is they do a lot of action in between. Like, it's almost like strategic and where they put the action. So there's a lot of action. There's some chasing going on. There's some obviously blowing things up. And of course with Mayfield, he's kind of off the hinge a little bit. So he's, you know, obviously there's some complications. They get into the base. There's some things that have to happen. Mando takes his helmet off. They start sitting down with the general, which is, by the way, if you watch Batman Begins, he is actually the Thomas Wayne and Martha Wayne's killer, which is
really a
famous character in Batman.
Fuck that guy.
That actor,
dude.
Yep.
Who is Joe Cool, right?
Yep. And he obviously is freaking annoying, of course, because he's asking stupid questions and you're like, where is this going to go? And Mayfield he was talking basically a very sensitive subject with Mayfield, which he gloats about the atrocities committed by the Empire in an Operation Cinder, which Mayfield and the Mandalorian escape with the help of Finnick. Yep. So Dune and Fett are like outside. They're kind of like snipers with I always forget her name. She's Chung Lee from the Star
Finnick.
The or Finnick, right? She's Chung Lee from the 1994.
Bro, and they're like laying Overwatch
Street Fighter
down
movie.
Is she for sure Chung Lee in 1994?
Which is fucking so sick.
Yeah.
Bro,
that's the same actress that played Chung Lee 16 years ago.
I know. She's like 57 years old. I was telling Amber, she looks pretty good for.
She looks 25. Are you fucking kidding me? She's.
All right, boys, settle down.
Yeah. That's Chung Lee from. She's 57.
She's 57? Good for her, dude. I want her fucking moisturizer secret.
Moisturizer?
I don't think that works. You know, she's probably from like a humidity, like, you know, country. Like her family.
She's probably
lives in Hawaii.
Super vegan, runs like 10 miles a day and like works out.
So do
all the time. Do you?
I look terrible.
Yeah.
I look like a walking before picture. I work out all the time.
So anyways, Mayfield shoots that commanding officer, ensues the war, ensues the escape, and obviously they get the transmission, and Mando, in his normal badass style, sends a nice little message that was very similar to Gideon that he had given to him on... I'm coming after you.
It was like his fucking Taken moment. Like his Liam Neeson, like.
I have a very special set of skills.
Yeah, seriously.
Yeah.
He was like, guess what, motherfucker? I'm coming for you.
A jetpack. Yep.
So that's basically, you know, that's chapter 15. You know, it's we like to say in between episodes, but with some action and a little bit of purpose and a little bit of, You know, we talked about the helmet, and he was very critical throughout every episode up until that one. So about his helmet. So I think it's a very in between, but has some very significant moments episode.
Yeah, and I don't want to park on this episode too much, because obviously the finale is what we're here to talk about for the most part. Mm-hmm. But I thoroughly enjoyed chapter 15. I thought that it carried I honestly think Bill Burr is a better actor than he is a comedian. I thought he crushed it in this episode. And I like Bill Burr as a comedian, don't get me wrong. He's a little overly Boston for me, but for the most part, I enjoy his comedy. And he crushed the acting, I thought, in this role. And
he's funny.
I also watched King of Staten Island on
FS
the plane to Washington. with Pete Davidson. And Bill Burr crushes it in that movie too. So maybe I'm a little biased because I saw that. But I've been blown away by Bill Burr's acting chops, and this episode
it is surprising. Have you ever seen F is for Family on Netflix?
The cartoon? No, I know he's one of the voices, but
he's like the right. It's all about his like past life.
So it's just a bunch of Boston maniacs like, getting drunk and talking shit.
Pretty much. So through the whole episode. In the effort for family show, he talks about how he's gonna throw his son through the wall because that's how he grew up. He's like, I'm gonna fucking throw you through the wall. You act like that again. So I just kept saying that throughout the episode. He's gonna throw that guy through the wall. He's gonna throw that trooper through the wall, because that's what he says in the whole show.
Now he talks a lot. He doesn't do. I mean, he does some damage. He's a sharpshooter, but his mouth does most of the damage.
He's a pistol. Yeah,
he doesn't miss. I love the scene where he's a stormtrooper that doesn't miss. Guy.
Yeah.
And he's like, to the Empire, right? And then he fucking, like, they all cheers and he just shoots the guy in the chest. It's like, fuck, that was dope. All right.
Yeah.
Any thoughts on this episode, Z?
I think there's a couple significant things that we should touch on before we move on. The first one is Mayfeld. So Mayfeld as a character is interesting because I thought he was absolute trash in season one. He was involved in an episode that I felt was probably the lowest point of this season, of this series as a whole. I hated the episode. I hated the character. I thought it was like the cocky sharpshooter kind of trope that was like, I just didn't like it. I thought it was garbage. In this episode, Bill Burr, I agree, has an opportunity to like kind of push Mayfeld forward in the sense that we get to see that he was an Imperial that was involved in operations that he didn't agree with. That's why he deserted the Imperial Army, and he actually had a heart. Like he cared about the people that were killed during that operation, and he thought his commanding officer was a villain so much so that he risked his own life to be able to put a bullet into him. And that is a very fucking riveting story, and I agree that Bill Burr did a great job. Kind of brought the character to another level for me, like as a whole.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely.
The other thing that I think we need to touch on is the conversation he has with Mando while they're on their way to the big base. They're in a land cruiser, and he's talking to Mando as they're kind of passing like poorer families, and he's saying that, you know, everybody has a line that they like to draw until things get messy. And among many other things, he's also kind of saying like, yo, if you're poor, the Republic and the Empire are pretty much the fucking same. Like, they're all just ruling bodies, and you know, they all do fucked up shit, which I think is an interesting thing moving forward. But with Mando, we've kind of seen him have this creed, this like religious zeal about his version of Mandalore. Never show your face, never take your helmet off, you know, like all of these kind of rules that he's lived his life by. And that's kind of a foreshadowing to what the rest of the episode is, because ultimately things get hairy and Mando has to take his helmet off. He has to take his helmet off in the middle of this pretending to be an imperialist. And then afterwards, he kills a number of imperialists who quote unquote could be innocent to, you know, what's going on. And so I think that he bends a lot of his rules to kind of accomplish his mission, which makes Mayfeld's kind of foreshadowing correct. Like, you have a line, that's fine, but you cross it when things get hairy. Everybody does. And I think that's gonna matter moving forward.
Absolutely, it will. And we won't take up too much more time, but I think that the whole black and white aspect of life is just non-existent. You can force that perception on yourself or among others, but it's just not the way. Like, there's no, like, I know this is the way, but black and white is not the way. There's a lot of gray in the world, and to be so specifically disciplined to one belief or one way of life, it's almost ignorant, you know. Like, you gotta be flexible, you gotta be understanding. So it is interesting.
And I think Din Djarin is like gonna transition into more of like a flexible. I mean, actually, I don't know if I'd say he's gonna transition into more of a flexible belief system. But I think he's going to be confronted with that soon. Like, either you're going to be black and white or you're going to be flexible. And it's going to be like a car crash confrontation that his character is gonna have to deal with coming up. Yep.
It's huge.
Agreed.
I don't really have any other thoughts on that one. I mean, it was a pretty straightforward episode for me. So, wasn't anything like particular that stood out other than seeing Pedro Pascal's face for the first time.
Second time.
So, chapter 16 is called the Rescue. In this episode, they enlist the help of Bo-Katan and Koska Reeves to board Gideon's ship. Mando and Dune will board an Imperial shuttle and capture Dr. Pershing, if I'm correct on that one. And Bo-Katan's obviously goal is to get the Darksaber because it makes her the ruler of their culture. I'm going to say that right. And the Mandalorian considers helping them to helping them to liberate Mandalore. They use the shuttle to get close enough to crash land on Gideon's cruiser. And while Fett is pretending to attack them, so it's kind of a ruse, right? It's kind of a, you know, trap. And obviously, it wasn't that big of a ruse, but they were able to get the bay doors open and slam their ship in there, and jump out like badasses because it was like a 1980s hairband metal scene with like fog coming out, and the band members were about to hit the stage, and the audience is like waiting in anticipation, and all of a sudden, you know, it's just Bo-Katan and Dune, which Dune is, she's kind of a badass. She's kind of like,
Dune.
Dune sucks. Yeah.
Dude,
we've been over this.
You don't like.
I mean, her character's pretty fucking beastie though. She's kind of like Amos in The Expanse. I don't know if you guys get that.
I would say she's like that character from like Predator. Not. You know, Amos she's has like the muscle.
Fucking like. Amos is a way better actor than what's her name.
They're pretty much the exact same. I think it's like a 1-to-1 comparison character? All the way across the board. They're the same actor. They're
very same character. Amos does not have that stupid smirk on his face every time it cuts to him. Like, he's fucking tough. Like, he is a good actor.
He always has a smirk on his face.
Gina Carano is an actual MMA person. Yeah,
she would probably beat his ass, actually, she's in RL.
Oh, for sure she would. But that doesn't mean she's a great actress.
She looks like she's pretty buff. Like, I'm not even like.
I don't know though, dude. The actor that plays Amos is quite a large.
He's a fight, actually. Let's get a
case. This is such a random eyeballs. Tangent. I did not mean to put us on this.
Amos versus Cara Dune, dude. That'd be a fucking battle for the ages. I would fucking pay
Okay, quickly. Let's just do like rapid fire. Who wins? Jordan, go.
Amos.
The characters though. Amos beats her. All right, JR?
I think so.
If it's the characters, I'm going to go with Dune. She's fucking rabid. Like, she's will headbutt you and bite you.
More of a heart than Amos, though, I think.
Yeah.
Amos is...
I'm going Amos. All right, let's move on.
All right. So, Bo-Katan, Kosak, Finnick, and Dune fight through stormtroopers to the cruiser's ship. Meanwhile, Mando heads off to look for the child and encounters Gideon with the Darksaber over the child's head, who looked sort of weak at that moment. You know, looked like he was about to take a nap. Grogu. And looks baby sleeps. He's tired.
Wasn't sleepy. He was
but
tired.
Of course, he's tired. He's baby naps. But of course Mando doesn't, he has like, the one thing I don't know, it's kind of hard to, I guess, I don't know, understand is Mando's so much dedication. Like he went from having one type of like focus in life, and then just kind of switch that hyper focus to the child. I mean, he was pretty much giving up the dark saber. I don't want that. I don't care. Go do what you got to do.
I don't think
just
he ever wanted the dark
child.
Saber though. There was
no, he didn't. Yeah. What I'm saying is, like, he has this hyper focus about stuff. Like, when he's a Mandalorian, the religion, his hyper focus was that, like, you don't take your helmet off, you don't. But then all of it, like, and so, but that hyper focus changed to the child. So when the guy had the, you know, when Moff Gideon was saying Moff that Gideon. Bo-Katan is here because Moff Gideon was saying that Jared Gideon, whatever, was there. It was because she wanted the dark saber, and he didn't care about any of the deals that he made with her. He's like, I don't care about any of that, just give me the kid.
Correct.
You know, and obviously Gideon is a douchebag, so he
douchebag
and double crosses him, and the fight ensues with the dark troopers. Is that what they called them? I don't remember. The dark troopers.
Yeah, they're dark
and
troopers.
Basically
yeah.
It's which sets up a very tough situation for the rescue crew, and Mando gets his butt kicked pretty good.
He gets fucking wrecked,
except for his armor stands up really well though.
So he has to fight a dark trooper, and it's actually pretty cool how it happens. The dark troopers are coming out. There's like 30 of them, and he manages to close the door. One of them gets out like Terminator style by putting his hands in between the fucking doors and like ripping the door open before it slams shut, which is perfect because it ends up being Mando versus one dark trooper. And I think they do this on purpose because they need you to know really what that fight is like a power level gauge. You get to see like a scale of power levels in that fight because you see one dark trooper versus Mando, who we've watched work everything that's come in front of him for roughly 2 seasons now. And he fucking barely makes it out of that fight. Barely makes it out of that fight with just
he
one.
He barely
of them.
Wins. Yeah.
So now, if you have an entire crew of them, I mean, it's almost like you're fucked. Like, you have no shot.
Right. Yeah. And he did defeat. I think a good point I forgot to mention is he did defeat Gideon in a 1-on-1 battle with his
easy money. And Gideon
spear.
Knew he was gonna lose. That's why he felt like he needed to like trick Mando by saying like, yeah, take the kid. Like, I think he kind of knew like in a 1-on-1 in a enclosed space he had no shot.
Right.
Question.
Right.
Gideon's smart as fuck, right? Or appears to be. And if he knew he needed deception to win the battle, wouldn't he know that Beskar is going to deflect his fucking darksaber? Like, if he tries to sneak attack a guy in 100% Beskar armor, like, it's not going to work. Like, wouldn't he know that?
Yeah, I mean, I think he would. I think that he can be a smart person and still overestimate his ability to win the fight. And I think that's what happened. I think he felt like he would definitely win if he had a couple shots on Mando when Mando wasn't looking.
Or he was desperate, I guess. Just like, whatever I can do.
And so he did. I mean, he tricked Mando, and then he swung on Mando's back a couple times, and it didn't work out, bro. He shot a shot, dog. And it clanked off the backboard, bro. Like, what more do you need from this man? He did his best.
I want more. We'll get into it. Right. Go ahead, JR.
So the end is upon us. If the last sequence, hint, hint. So at this point, they once the dark troopers are outside, which I do remember them being able to fly, so I kind of knew that they were coming back into the scene. They just got into space. They come back and start to force their way back onto the ship, and now everybody's scared shitless. But then all of a sudden, a X-Wing appears. And I don't know anybody else.
X-Wing.
Yeah, a single one. You never see a single one unless it's a very special person that comes through there with a fake hand. I mean, I don't know. This guy in cloaks shows up. I mean, he's got one leather glove.
Green saber.
I don't know who that was. Like, I couldn't. Yeah, green. I was like, who is this? Like, is this a new Jedi that shows up
no,
and
it's
just
Disney. They would
smashes?
Never introduce a new character.
just smashes. I mean, I thought it was Sebastian Stan, I don't know.
I didn't really notice the gloved hand until, like,
I saw the glove right away.
The first thing I saw, besides the X-Wing, I saw the gloved hand. I was like, fuck.
Yeah, the X-Wing by itself and the leather glove and all black. And just the, like, I guess the way he was walking, too, is kind of similar. It reminded me of the scene from Rogue One where Darth Vader was walking through the hallways and
I think that they did that on purpose.
Yeah,
I did too. Sure. So it kind of reminded me of that. So I thought that was very giving on who this was. The green lightsaber, which is, I love that lightsaber. Luke Skywalker appears and saves the day. And it wasn't even like a challenge for him. It was like watching Madden and doing spin moves and like jumping over like 15. I don't think so. And
for the record,
please.
I don't know, but and he shows up. R2-D2 shows up, which I thought is amazing. I love R2-D2; is my favorite. And is there to, because the child did call. He did make a 411, if you will, a couple episodes out into the Force, and I did not predict Luke Skywalker to be there. I really didn't think they would go.
I mean, me and Z predicted that shit. No, I think we feared this. We're like, okay, so he obviously got in contact with the Jedi, and
we talked about which Jedi it would be. I wanted it to be Mace Windu.
Right.
Yeah.
And Mace Windu. I think you were talking Cal. Was it? We said Cal.
He fucking is, Jordan.
Cal Kipkiss.
But Cal, yeah, we thought him. I knew that. I didn't.
Been there.
Cal Ripken is what I was going to say. Cal Ripken.
It should have.
Kal-El.
It should have been Ezra, and I'll go more into that later. But yes, it was Luke.
But he's there to take the child under training, and the child. This is kind of a sad moment. Mando takes his helmet off.
Alicia cried. Child.
Really?
Tears, real tears.
Dude, a lot of people cried for sure. Matt, our boy over at Hobbs Geek News, he cried his eyes off.
Dude, a lot of people cried. This was a big. We did not cry. Just like a big ass moment in Star Wars lore.
We must be pricks, because Amber and I did not cry at all.
I get the feeling that you don't love Star Wars, dude.
We can go into that after we finish this last segment. But Luke Skywalker saves the day, takes the child, leaves. And obviously it's kind of almost like a cliffhanger, but not just enough of an ending to make you satisfied, but there's still a little bit left to explore, which I know they're making a season 3 for the end of 2021. So there we go. Mando is out.
Okay, so couple things. First of all, I think it's important for us to have been able to see Mando fight the Dark Trooper, because then Luke shows up, and I think you really get a sense of like how fucking crazy powerful Luke is. Like, for him to just work his way through an entire dark trooper squadron with ease. Like, he's not even moving fast. It's, like, slow. He's, like, fucking force-crushing them. Like, it's like, this dude's a god. Which is hilarious, because we talked about Luke the goat, and you were not about it, but I urge you to reconsider, sir. Anyway,
I wasn't about
it. I think that the other thing I wanted to mention is his battle with Moff Gideon. So, Din Djarin.
I wasn't about Luke being the goat.
No, JR was against Luke being the goat. And it sounds he still is. This man still wants to live in ignorance. That's fine.
Luke is definitely the goat.
Okay. It is not the goat.
He's absolutely the goat. What? But, okay,
who the fuck can touch him?
There is no other there is no other Jedi out there. Of course there's no one who's going to touch
even
him.
In
he's
the history
not
of
been
Jedi,
challenged
Ezra,
his whole life.
Dog, Ezra.
Okay, in the history of Jedi, Luke Skywalker is the most powerful Jedi of all time. Like, he
for sure.
He ends up being maybe not even at the moment that he takes Grogu as his first apprentice, but at the moment of like his ascending. When, like, way into the future that we see in the movies, he's the fucking goat. Like, he only gets more powerful as he gets older. And he's already a giant legend, because he fucking beat Darth Vader and killed the Emperor. I mean, that's insane. He toppled the Empire completely.
Did he really beat Darth Vader, or did Darth Vader realize what evil
he
had become?
And he definitely beat Darth Vader.
I don't know.
Wait a minute. There's a scene where he gets Darth Vader on his back, and Luke Skywalker starts raining blows down on Darth Vader, and Darth Vader is just, like, opening them, taking him, and then he cuts Darth Vader's hand off. Like, that is a defeat, son. That is a defeat. That's like saying, like, yo, did he really beat that guy as he's just, like, blasting this guy's face on the mat? Like, that's a defeat, bro. He beat him.
I love Luke Skywalker. Don't get me wrong. I love the omniscience of Luke Skywalker. But if we're going to think about it as in battles and fights, who he's beaten, who's on his card. I mean, that's great that he beat Darth Vader. But he didn't beat Palpatine. He didn't, you know.
Like that, don't roll your eyes.
Think he beat Darth Vader. I don't really think he beat him.
Because
he got that.
Died. Does he technically beat
But he came
Palpatine?
Back.
No. But he is instrumental in the overthrowing of the Emperor and
he beat
the toppling of the Empire.
Warrior.
I just feel like there's not enough. Data.
What more do you
for him
need,
to be
dude? I don't want to spend the entire episode
see,
doing this, but like, oh, what fuck. More
I
do you need?
See him,
like,
I want right, to see him right, fight getting, more.
I'm sorry. Okay,
one question,
and then we move on. Who's the most powerful Jedi of all time?
I believe it's Obi-Wan.
Obsidious?
Obi-Wan?
I think Obsidious is.
No. The reason I say Obi-Wan is one. If you watch the first three movies, he is in every battle. He is fighting every Jedi. He obviously beats Anakin.
Obi-Wan wasn't even the most powerful Jedi on his team.
He doesn't have the M count. He doesn't have the M count, dog. Luke has the M count.
He wasn't more powerful than Yoda.
How does he not have the M count?
He got killed by Darth Vader, who Luke beat.
If we're going off of what we've
seen. He got killed by Darth Vader. He gave up to be more powerful.
He wanted to be a Force Ghost because he gave up because he knew he couldn't beat Darth Vader.
He gave up.
If you strike, he was also 90, and he said, "If you strike me down, I'll be more powerful than you ever imagined." And he was. So don't say Vader.
He lost. He lost to Darth Vader. Luke beat him. That's all I'm saying.
Remember when he actually beat Anakin and cut him in half? Because that happened in his prime. In both
yeah, he cut his legs off.
That did.
Yeah.
And I'm just like Obi-Wan. To me, always had the foresight to help Luke Skywalker. It's not like,
you know who
Luke
have
is
the
just
foresight?
He was a
Yoda.
Who didn't Yoda? That's true. I do agree with the Yoda not having it. The foresight. Yoda had no foresight.
He's a big Star Wars fan, I know, and he's like, I'm on Team Zach, like. And he's got,
and he gets all this respect and all this credit. Does he also agree and realize that Luke Skywalker is the GOAT and JR is absolutely wilding right now? Not fucking Obi-Wan, that's for sure. Anyway, he's a god.
He is not a god.
Luke becomes a god. Like, Luke becomes a god.
Yeah, because, dude.
First of all, he's already a god at a young age because he defeats the Empire, he beats Darth Vader, but then over time, he ends up doing things that nobody's ever done before. He ends up being able to, like, be at two places at once and, like, fight battles with a hologram of himself using the Force. Like, these are techniques that, like, nobody can do. Nobody's ever done that shit before. Like, he ends up, like, bringing new shit to the Force that nobody's ever done.
It's definitely a discussion.
Okay. Time out. I hear you, and I already know where you're gonna go with that. Let's pin that. I just want to make one quick comment about Din Djarin beating Moff Gideon. So when Din Djarin,
the Beskar spear, which was dope.
Yes. Also, when the spear was, like, against the lightsaber and it was started to, like, glow red and shit, that was pretty sick. Din Djarin beats Moff Gideon and takes the Darksaber, which ends up being a big deal because Bo-Katan, that was the whole reason why she was there. And the reason why she wants the Darksaber because she wants to rule Mandalore. Mandalore has like very strict rules about how rulers are appointed, essentially, and it's always trial by combat. And so whoever has the Darksaber, you have to defeat in combat and then get the Darksaber, you become the ruler. So when Din Djarin walks into that room with Moff Gideon and the Darksaber in his hand, he's essentially the ruler of Mandalore. At that point in time,
unfortunately,
he is the king of Mandalore, without a doubt, 150%. And Bo-Katan knows it, and so does Moff Gideon. And that's why Moff Gideon starts kind of trolling, because he's like, you know, he's talking to Bo-Katan. He's like, no, she's not going to take that. He tries to give it away. He doesn't want it, but it's his.
No, he says, oh, you're going to spare my life. This should be interesting. And, like, smirks. Like, he knows what's going to fucking come when he doesn't kill him.
Yes, yes.
Because and, it's the drama of the Darksaber.
And this is one of my predictions. I think that this story can go in a direction in which Bo-Katan and Din Djarin end up becoming rivals to be the ruler of Mandalore. Because in that moment, I think she's kind of like calculating and assessing, like, the way to get the Darksaber from Din Djarin is not to take it, like, with him giving it to you, but to, like, either kill him or beat him in battle to get it. Then it would be a legit, you'd be the ruler of Mandalore at that point. And so I think that, like, if moving forward, the story could go in a direction in which they end up becoming rivals and trying to be the leader of Mandalore. That's one of my theories. I have three.
He doesn't want it, though, so I don't feel like there's going to be a huge thing. He doesn't want to be the ruler of Mandalore. He wants, I mean, at least he did want to take care of Grogu. Now Grogu's gone. Maybe that's his new passion.
That's the thing, because Grogu is not going to be in the future. I don't think Grogu, they're not going to just show Grogu and Luke training together. It's not going to happen. So they're going to have to find like
teen Grogu comes back.
Like, I just don't think it's
250-year-old teen Grogu comes back.
I don't think it's going to happen. I think they're going to have to take the story into a different direction.
And what if it turns into an episode of Full House on Tatooine and teen Grogu comes back? He's lovesick. And fucking Mando's Danny Tanner and Bill Burr is Jason Stamos. You guys into this? No?
Mm-mm. Let me throw another theory. Go ahead, JR.
See, this is kind of the problem I do have with Star Wars a little bit, is we have such a far in advance under like storylines with it.
I'm glad you brought this up.
Because now, like, you're missing, and maybe this is where they're trying to fill in that gap, but there is...
Well, what gap, though?
That's like, where is he during these epic battles between Rey and and all that?
Where
was Ahsoka Tano during the whole fucking original trilogy?
Is he hiding in the swamp like Yoda was, or
Ahsoka
what?
Ahsoka Tano is more of a mystery to me, but I can tell you about Luke. So there is a 6-year instance in Luke Skywalker's life in which nobody knows what happened. And it's like a free-for-all for this series.
He was raging.
Which is now bringing Luke into it. And the reason why I know that is because what we know is that Luke starts to train Ben Solo. And what we know before he trained Ben Solo is that he had a academy of Jedi that he was training. Of which Ben Solo, like, did a little mini Order 66 and kind of murked all of them and set it on fire and then became Kylo Ren. So,
well, that's your boy too. So fuck him.
I love Kylo Ren. He's my favorite character of this entire title.
He's the worst.
He's not. He's the best. Anyway, so what we have is we have Luke from toppling the Empire to training a young Ben Solo and having like a little orphanage of Jedi. There's like roughly 6 years that we don't know what happened. That, like, this show is now in position to answer for us, essentially, with Grogu as his apprentice. And we don't know if he's going to be part of that, like, massacre. If Ben Solo ends up just massacring him, I mean, that would be really terrible, but
there's no way.
there's a 6-year window that nobody knows anything about that, like, this show is in position now to answer for.
Yeah, they're gonna have to, because there is, I mean, unless they just, it is Disney, so it's really hard to say what, you know, they're gonna do what they want, but it's just sometimes it's so discouraging, because you're just like, you want more, but you're like, kind of like, how?
I honestly think this episode of Mandalorian might have been the best Star Wars thing I've ever seen since.
Oh, you're one of those. So you got the 10-year-old in the movie theater for the first time seeing Luke Skywalker feeling when he was walking down that hallway slaying droids.
Oh, for sure. Okay. Yeah.
Okay. And Bran's the same way. A lot of people are the same way. I get that.
And it was like almost emotional. It was like, This is the Star Wars that, like, we needed. And it's like Jon Favreau and his team are totally bringing it back to, like, its roots and what it's supposed to feel like. And so I felt like this was the best Star Wars thing I've ever seen. One of the best Star Wars things I've ever seen. Now, having
this
said that,
this is so contradictory to everything you've said.
That being said,
before
that
this episode.
Now, having said that, am I disappointed that they brought the Skywalker saga back into Mandalorian? I am. I'm disappointed. I that Jedi could, for me, could have been a number of other characters, and I would have had a similar reaction. Maybe
Ezra.
Even a more, Ezra. A better reaction to this scene. The fact that it was Luke is not what did it for me. It was the drama, the sadness, the danger from the dark troopers, the surprise of the single X-Wing. Like, it was all of that.
They teed this storyline up. I mean, it was like a perfect, like, domino effect all the way down. Like, you knew, like, I did not predict Luke Skywalker. I mean, I was hoping for a new Jedi to appear, because it'd be really cool to go down that path of a
new
Jedi.
So was I. Jordan.
I even if it was Mace Windu, I was excited about it, because I mean, at least we get to see something different. But they teed it all up. I mean, the way, if you look back on everything was for this moment, and you're like, is it for the Luke Skywalker moment, or is it for a storyline that is supposed to continue? I think they're going to end the Grogu conversation. I think this is it for the child. It's not going to be in the, it's done. And the Mandalorian is going to head towards Mandalore stuff. That's what I think is going
to
happen.
This I would like to counter that with my second theory. I think that the Mandalorian as a whole might be over for a minute.
You think Mando's character is over?
I think.
But aren't they making a season 3?
I think
it should be.
I think that they might shift that, like, time slot, or, I mean, it's a streaming service, but, like, I think they might shift
Friday
to
stream.
The Book of Boba Fett. until the
Book of Boba Fett.
Definitely
doing a
Boba
Fett one.
Because I think that,
which,
like, the Mando story is, and this is just a theory, same as my last one, I have no fucking idea, but, like, it feels like it's in a place where they can kind of put a pin in it for a minute and move on to, like, other stories like Ahsoka and Bo-Katan and all these other things.
Like I said earlier, so they already have signed on for a third season. So, like, Mandalorian's happening. It's just
It's supposed to go into production after the Book of Boba Fett spinoff.
Like, the Mandalorian, or are
it's Mandalorian season 3, and then Boba Fett is has a spinoff, and apparently he goes back to Tatooine and kills who's that guy that took over for Jabba the Hutt? His apprentice kills him and takes over and becomes the
King of the
mob
Underworld,
boss
of the
or
galaxies.
Something.
Yeah, Boba Fett sits on the throne of Jabba with Finnick at his side, and that's the Book of Boba Fett. JR. Any thoughts on the Skywalker resurgence?
A couple of things. One, it was cool to see something that is from such a great story, you know, with the first release movies, you know, episode 4, 5, and 6. Like, it was good to see. I mean, it was daunting. Like I said, he reminded me of Darth Vader coming the way he did. I wasn't like, I thought that was cool. Thanks, like, I thought that was a good, like, but it's not like I got overexcited about it. I as soon as I saw the X-Wing, I was like, oh, well, it's going to be Luke Skywalker. So, and he, you know, walks in cool Luke, like always, right? That's where that term almost came from, cool Luke. But yeah, I wasn't like overwhelmed or overexcited, or like, it didn't take me to that climactic moment that other things have. And it's really not, I don't know. I just think it was something that Disney threw in. It's something that John, hey, let's get them excited. Let's get them. And it's just throw Luke in there. And I don't think anything is going to come of it. That's why I think that the child goes, it's the end. I think this is just kind of like, I don't know if it's going to be a Skywalker like takeover again. I don't think it is. I think they're just going to just straight out just, hey, let's throw something fun. Oh yeah, let's throw some Luke in there and digitize his face. And I mean, it's just, I feel like that's how it is. I don't know. I don't see anything big. I'm trying to see some more. They've got some other shows coming out. I mean, they've got Rangers of the New Republic. I can't say her name. Rosario Dawes. Ashoka? I say it
Rosario
for me.
Dawson? Ahsoka Tan?
Yeah. And she's going to be in there. Set in the timeline of the Mandalorian.
Do you like Star Wars? I'm sorry. I got to know.
Do I like Star Wars? Like Star Wars.
I feel like you don't. I feel like you're low-key just like trudging through this.
I don't hate Star Wars. And I've said as many. I don't love it. I don't hate it. Hate's a really strong word. I like Star Wars. I like.
You said I enjoy.
I enjoy certain things about Star Wars, but there are a lot of things I don't enjoy about Star Wars. I enjoy the books. Like, if you read Star Wars books, they're one of the most fascinating things to read. And there's a lot of things that they've pulled out of the books. And I've actually heard that they haven't given a lot of credit to those writers yet about some of the things that they're pulling out of those books.
Disney?
But
blasphemous.
I know,
hey,
but
Favre and Filoni are actually pulling from a ton of material.
Anything pulls from the extended universe, it's the Mandalorian. They have pulled so many.
Yeah, I mean, I love.
They're pulling a ton from that.
Especially
Johnny Favre is a he's a great writer and a great director. So it's not like anything bad. And he's kind of done this before a little bit, you know, like we talked about a couple episodes ago. He was on, he wrote and he directed Elf, and he kind of had a lot of influence with a lot of the old animated movies for Christmas, those shortstop movies, you know. So he really does kind of, he gets inspired and he starts writing about it, which is great. I think it's great. But I've read the books, and the books are so intense and they're so intriguing. And then I watched some of this, and I've watched the movies, like the first episode 4, 5, and 6. I absolutely love. I love those characters. I totally dig that stuff. And I know the first three episodes, episode 1, 2, and 3, are kind of dramas, but I actually kind of like them. I'll be honest, I kind of love episode 2. I love seeing Anakin. I love seeing the fighting. I love seeing the where they took that next step. I'm just having a hard time these days. I hated the last three. I'll be honest with you. I loved Rogue One, but I hated the last three.
Rogue One was great.
I don't know. I'm just not having such a great time with it. And I like The Mandalorian because, like, before Luke got there, it was completely different, right? We're getting to see something.
Makes the galaxy,
and it made me laugh,
bigger.
And it is really good, right? Yeah, and it really is good writing. It really is. I mean, we're getting to see some guest actors, which is great. But as a whole right now, my Star Wars level has gone down quite a bit.
That's
like,
fair. I fuck with all that. One thing, and then I think we should pass it to Jordan, because I know he's got a lot of thoughts he wants to lay on us. I can recognize that the last three Star Wars movies are not widely accepted as great. I love Kylo Ren, and I know that's an unpopular opinion. I have heard that it could be possible that Jon Favreau and the team are using The Mandalorian to retcon a lot of the things that happen in those three movies.
Like, redo it.
Yes, because it was done trash. I mean, one of those movies was like a space chase that never amounted to
I don't
anything.
Even remember the second one at all.
It
like
was
that's
trash,
how,
dude. Like, there
I can't,
are
I know
a lot
I watched
of
gar- it.
That, it's a lot of garbage. I'm not, for sure, it's not great. So, yeah, just take that. I hear everything you're saying. This might be like the attempt to fix it. Because I think Jon Favreau and Filoni are like actual legit Star Wars fans that are like doing it correctly, as opposed to just randos that like did those three. We'll see what happens.
It'd be great to see Luke redone. I'll be honest with you. Like, you get to kind of see.
And they're
what...
in a position to do it now. Because they're like, was Luke doing before the First Order? Let's think about that. It could be a retcon, it could be fixing the timeline. But let's sit back and listen to Jordan's shit on everything I just said.
I just don't know what happened to you, man. Like, we would have these talks, and we'd talk about the Skywalker saga, and we're like, let's let the universe grow. Let's get out of this fucking saga, and let's see something fresh. Let's see something new. And kind of, our prayers were answered with The Mandalorian. It was fresh. It was new. It had references, but the best kind of references, where it was like pulls from Clone Wars or pulls from Rebels or pulls from the EU, like stuff we haven't seen already in the Lucas universe. And here you come promoting the resurgence of Luke Skywalker like it's genius. And you're not promoting it's genius. I know, I'm just giving you shit. But I still don't sense the frustration that I want to see from you. And this is exactly what we predicted Disney would do. And is that because of the last trilogy? Yes, 100%. If that last trilogy never happened, I would have had the biggest hard-on for the fucking finale. But instead, it was like a slow fart of a finale. Just a little...
Oh, wow. Fucking that's so shit.
That we saw coming. Literally predicted it. And now we're trying to like find reasons.
Oh,
like,
my gosh.
Why was that the right decision? Why was that the right thing? Like, it was overwhelmingly disappointing. But what happens next? And that's what I'm excited about. And I hope they do it right. But I am nervous because there is a third season of The Mandalorian that's already confirmed. And now there is a season of The Book of Boba Fett, which
will come out first.
Dope,
and then
but
The Mandalorian.
How many Mandalorian seasons do we need going on at once? What are your guys' thoughts on CGI and great actors to reprise roles from their youth? How do you feel about this? Because it's been a new trend. Started with Pac live in concert, and now it's just happening around us. Like I feel weird about it. If I'm being honest, I feel like it's like a disgrace to art. But what do you guys feel?
Disgrace to art? I think it's like an ode to art. I think it's like an ode to like the actors that played these characters. Granted, the CGI looks.
It looks
trash. It is clearly a CGI situation, but it's still Mark Hamill reprising his role. And so I think that like for the sake of kind of posterity, like for like him being able to bring Luke back to the people, like that's dope.
Honestly, I get like, the love for Star Wars.
If this experiment with you guys, like following the Mando and doing this whole thing has taught me anything, it's that like, I'm a fucking huge Star Wars fan. And it's funny to you guys, but, like, I didn't actually, like, realize that about myself until, like, just a couple days ago when I thought about, like, all the season finales or movie, like, premieres I've gone to by myself. I've literally spent the night at movie theaters by myself before. I'm low-key kind of a purist. Like, I'm really into this shit. So, maybe, maybe that is true. Like, maybe the fact that Luke has shown up has, like, got me all giddy because I love Star Wars, and I can tell you guys don't as much.
Well, I was going to say, like, it is kind of hard. I've actually talked to many Star Wars fans in the last, I don't know, couple years, and they're just like, I'm a Spider-Man fan, I'm willing to put aside some of the mistakes or some of the things and some of the issues because you're such a fan. So I get the love and the lore for Zach on the Star Wars and some of the things that are hyping him up. People were hyped up about Luke. Particularly in the comic book store, they're talking about it, and they're so hyped up about it.
Just people cry.
See
dude.
Him from their Not childhood.
Me. Not me. I didn't cry. Yeah. But real people cried, like actual people.
Yeah,
cried.
They were so hyped up about it. I understand.
I didn't cry. I don't even know how to cry, but actual people cried, like real hard ass gangsters cried.
He's crying right
like,
now.
Real thugs cried and shit. Like actual.
It's okay.
People that,
it's okay
like,
to cry.
Street cred, fucking cried. You know what I'm saying?
I understand. I'm kind of on that same thing where it's really hard to get super into it because in the grand scheme of things, I like the grand scheme of things. Like if I didn't know about Rey or anybody,
you
Mando would probably be way better.
The
for
finale,
me.
Like
I know,
like you, have
I can't do it.
Stuck.
They switched up Palpatine
stuck.
Right at
Bro,
the
but
end.
We have a pocket
it,
of time that we don't
yeah,
know what happened.
Stuck
it,
the
they're
gonna retcon.
You
gotta
sit
it means,
in the now.
It means
they're
nothing
gonna
to me.
Retcon this.
It means nothing. I hope so. I hope they do. I hope they just said, hey,
they're
that was actually
it.
Like they did with Star Trek in 2009. They're like, let's just see if we could just switch
yes.
it all up by changing the time, by going back in time and changing, you know, Kirk's, George,
Captain Kirk?
George Kirk, and he actually died. And no, what, I'm gonna start, Captain Kirk's dad is called George Kirk.
Let's not get into this. You're right.
And so he,
you're right. Whatever the
yes,
conversation is.
But
ooh,
he,
Star Trek.
Yeah, but he, so he changes, and I hope, and there were some cool things about it, but it's just so hard to get into it. This is why I love the books, because there's so much. I'm reading a timeline from the very beginning, you know what I mean? Before, and you're not, like, there's so many great things, but I also stopped reading the books, too, because I got to the point where I'm at, Return of the Jedi or whatever, and I'm like, I fucking know what happens. Like, I don't want to read this book now. Like,
yeah.
I know what happens,
yeah.
and...
I actually think Disney's going to do a great job.
Well, they have the money to do a great job. So that's the great thing
they're
about
Disney.
They're
putting the right people... Like, they're putting the right decision-makers in place.
Well, they have
like,
to. If they
Fav
don't, then
and
it's just
Filoni, these guys are these guys are the right guys to be running
No,
this,
I totally
this,
agree.
This
I totally agree with that.
And also... But, like, overall, as a whole, we've got to start telling stories... outside of this timeline.
We
have,
to
move past
we have
it.
To.
We have to
Well,
start
yeah, I would totally love that.
With new characters and new like villains and like a new problem. We just have to. So
yes, and get over this whole anti-government
within this timeline, that's fine. My third theory is the series takes a turn towards Moff Gideon. Moff Gideon is still alive. Moff Gideon openly admitted to needing Grogu's blood, and we don't really know why he needed Grogu's blood. And I think that the series could turn into like a almost murder mystery, like Moff Gideon escapes, but then they like try to track him down, and then they track him down and try to realize why they need Grogu's blood, and then like the ultimate ending is that they need Grogu's blood because they're going to create a clone of Emperor Palpatine. Which could ultimately end up being Snoke, and I think that would be interesting.
And actually, Palpatine did die, but it's actually a clone that fights Rey at the end.
And they need Force power to create that clone. And then that would be another. Honestly, it could be part of the retcon because like then Snoke doesn't become some random fucking villain, but
yeah,
becomes. A clone of Palpatine, which Grogu's blood helped create, which then makes it all make a little bit more sense.
Mandalorian is happening, and they have a third season. What's it going to be about? Which is interesting. I feel like it's going to be about Mandalore.
Know.
I feel like it has to be about Mandalore. I feel like it has to be about the Darksaber.
So it's going to be Bo-Katan versus Din Djarin.
In control of Mandalore is like the ultimate goal. But I don't think that...
and Grogu essentially is going to get phased out of this.
But there is a there is a conversation they have in chapter 15, Boca and Mando, where she's like, I need the ship to retake Mandalore, and if everything goes right, I want you at my side. And he goes, okay.
And he said, fuck you.
No, he said, okay.
He didn't care about anything she said.
No, he wanted to get...
He wanted to get Grogu back.
Like, whatever it took to get Grogu back. And, but he...
Dingerin said he would
he
help
essentially
her.
Said, okay.
He double-crossed her applesauce her.
I don't think he double-crossed her. I think that's foreshadowed.
Double-cross applesauce?
It's crisscross applesauce.
He didn't give two. She's about to give that shit up. I don't care. He double-crossed her applesauce her.
Oh, let's get into this. All
right. You know what sounds good? Chicken McNuggets.
I am on my sixth beer of 8.3%, so I will go first. I think this chapter 15 was craft. I think that chapter 16 was craft as well. Neither of these episodes are trash. No episode in the season was trash.
Dude, I was about to go ham.
I wanted to so bad. But I think that this was actually a good season. And I think that chapter 15 was better than chapter 16. I think I gave chapter 15 a 7.5. And I gave chapter 16 a 6. And I've given all of my reasons why. I think chapter 15 surprised me. Bill Burr's character, I was a little annoyed they were bringing him back, and surprised they brought that character back after his, in my opinion, flop in season one. But he did a really good job, and it was...
Agreed.
There was tension, there was drama, there was heart, there was great dialogue, great conversation, good action. I thought it was just a really good episode. And then chapter 16 was... There was a lot of action. It happened, like, a lot of stuff happened really fast, and it was entertaining, but... I just was really disappointed with the expected outcome that happened. So, I have 7.5 for 15 and a 6 for 16. JR.
I agree. I mean, all the episodes were great and entertaining. Like, I wasn't, like, disgusted by any of them. So, definitely all craft. And I think, for me, it's a little bit more even. 6.5 for both.
I'm impressed.
It was great to see. It's great to see. I mean, the Bill Burr character was fun to watch, but it wasn't like exciting to me. I do like a little bit more of 15 because the helmet thing was a big deal for me. But I think the action was a little better in. I love the fight against Gideon and Mando. So I thought that was pretty dope, and I love that he was double cross applesauce everybody and just for his focus purpose. So I think a 6.5 for both is probably my rate for both of them.
What a non-Star Wars 6.5. Fan would say. Okay, Zach?
I'm not a non. Well, I get it. He's disgusted.
6.57s? These are absolutely asinine numbers, bro. Are you absolutely out of your mind?
You're like a-holes.
Chapter 15 was an incredible episode in which they brought a character that I didn't fucking like into this episode and made me love him. They gave him a heart. They gave him a reason why. They gave him a kind of a bad decision that came from his, like, his reason why, and I believed in it. I thought it was dope. So I'm going to give that episode a 8. I think it, which is pretty much on par. It wasn't, like, the craziest episode, but it was heart. It was Din Djarin having to face his kind of, like, demons in like, his evangelical beliefs, and it was this Bill Burr character who I hated ending up love. That was pretty rad. Mm-hmm. Chapter 16 is seriously one of the best things in Star Wars I've ever seen in my life.
God damn it.
It is the reason why I have given other episodes lower ratings, because I fucking knew that something like this was coming. I just knew it. I knew it, and here we get that exact thing. Luke showing up, murking the dark troopers, Grogu saying goodbye to Din Djarin, him taking his helmet off with everybody looking at him, knowing that they're looking at him, not giving a fuck, saying goodbye to his son, giving him to the Jedi.
You mean bro, everything you predicted is what you're saying.
It's a 10.
10?
It's the best. It's not the best, but it's up there with Return of the Jedi, with Rogue One. It's literally up there with some of the best Star Wars experiences I've ever seen. Rogue One's up there, by the way. Don't sleep on Rogue One.
You fell asleep in the theater, bro. I was with you.
I've seen it multiple times since then, Jordan. This episode, this single episode, had you like fearing for Din Djarin's life, had you fucking rooting for him to get the Darksaber, had you realizing that like, oh shit, now he's the ruler of Mandalore, had you questioning like, what is that X-Wing, had you fucking in awe of Luke Skywalker murking all those Dark Troopers, and then had you crying when Grogu had to leave Din. It was like all the emotions. It was well written. It was well done. And it was amazing, bro. And like, I didn't cry, but a lot of people cried.
You cried for sure. You cried the hardest. You cried harder than anybody else on this planet. Dude. You cried harder.
In fucking credible. And more than anything, it tells you that the future of Star Wars is in great fucking hands, dude. Great hands. They are going to take this thing to the stars and back, bro. I believe in Favre and Filoni. I believe in them, dude. They're
I agree. Killers. I like those guys.
Look. We have our thoughts. We're amateurs on our thoughts. Let's go to the fucking comic book world genius of Anthony and see what he thinks.
Hello, this is Anthony Gramuglia coming in with my opinions on the Mandalorian season 2 finale. In a word, it was awesome. I've been writing about it for the last, I don't even know what it is now, 2 weeks now, week and a half at this point. The entire finale was spectacular. It was a good conclusion to the arc set up in season 2, and season 1 for that matter. It offered some really good character moments, I thought, for Cara Dune and Bo-Katan. But of course, the thing everyone's talking about are two real things. One, the whole Darksaber, plot point, you know, how Din Djarin's going to deal with owning the Darksaber. I think personally he'd make a good ruler for Mandalore, but, you know, there's going to be some confrontations with Bo-Katan going forward. He's going to talk about I think season 3 is going to really focus on the whole who is in charge of, of the culture, who's in charge of the planet, who's going to help rebuild the culture after this. A lot of really cool themes of tradition versus breaking free of your tradition. So, like, with the whole, like, way that, you know, Din Djarin is all like, I have to keep my helmet closed, I can't show anyone my face, and now it's obviously, he's taken off his helmet, he's shown himself, it's interesting what the dynamics of this thing are for that, but I guess everyone wants to talk about Luke Skywalker. He's pretty good in this. It was a surprise, didn't expect it, but I also kind of, but I also wasn't shocked, if that makes sense. I knew they'd have to bring in some notorious Jedi, well, famous Jedi for the finale. I figured it would be Ahsoka coming back, but Luke Skywalker. I love how they gave him a chance to really fill in the blanks between Jedi and The Force Awakens. I really like how they're setting up some stuff here to really bridge the gap between the two trilogies. Because that's one problem a lot of people have with The Force Awakens and the sequel trilogy. It was very much a... It felt disconnected from one another. They felt like they were separate things. And I like how they're with The Mandalorian, with Rangers, they're really, well, with the Rangers when it comes out, with Ahsoka, with the book of Boba Fett. I love how they're really bridging the gap, kind of adding their own little trilogy of sorts, their own little universe between the trilogies, and really showing that this world is in flux. I feel that history will be very kind to the Disney era, because we'll have everything at once. We'll be able to watch it chronologically. We'll be able to see how every component added up, and I think that's going to be really exciting to see develop over the next several years. I don't think Luke Skywalker showing up is going to change the trajectory of the show as much as some people do. I think Luke will be maybe have a few cameos throughout the series from this point onward, but I feel like what we're seeing right now is how our characters interact with the established continuity. And I'm really excited to see what season three brings, what Rangers of the New Republic brings, what Ahsoka brings, and of course what the Book of Boba Fett brings, because that post-credit scene, that was something going on with all that Bib Fortuna nonsense. That's my feelings in general. I think it's a really good finale. I'm happy with how it turned out. I'm excited to see what comes next. And I feel like it's going to be even more exciting to see the finished product, to see how all these plot threads established by different creatives, different directors, all tie together in the coming years of Disney Star Wars. So that's my opinions right there. If you like my opinions here, you should check out my podcast, the Pumpkin Core Horror Movie Podcast, where I talk about horror movies and all that stuff. Follow me on Twitter. That is my contribution for this time. Take care, guys.
All right. We love you. Merry Christmas.
Merry Christmas,
enjoy
everybody.
Enjoy your holidays. We totally appreciate
Happy
you.
This has been
Stay
fun.
Safe
I'm
out
hammered
there.
And
good night.
This is the way.